how many small particles do I have? And does that number of small particles have a significant association with events? Yes. And if you had a lot of small, you had a lot of trouble, and large was the good fluffy particle. And if you had the good fluffy particle, maybe you didn't have much risk, even though you had a lot of them. So lots of small particles is part of the fabric of insulin resistance and metabolic syndrome.
Are small LDLs, small LDL lipoproteins, more harmful than the large fluffy kind? Are the large fluffy LDLs harmless? Is it okay to have high cholesterol or high ApoB as long as my LDLs are of this large fluffy kind? Today we're answering all of these common questions. Our guest is Dr. William Cromwell, board certified clinical lipidologist and fellow of the National Lipid Association with 3 decades of experience diagnosing and managing lipoprotein and metabolic disorders. Dr. Cromwell heads the Lipoprotein and Metabolic Disorders Institute. He is founder and chief medical officer at Precision Health Reports, and he is also a professor at Wake Forest University School of Medicine. Dr. Cromwell was part of the first team of researchers that adapted the NMR technique to measure LDL particle size. And this is the technique that is nowadays routinely used for this purpose. He has published extensively on this question of lipoprotein size and cardiovascular risk. So here's my conversation with Dr. Cromwell.
A lot of viewers ask, what is the role of the particle size? If my LDL particles are smaller or larger, does that determine risk? What do we know from the data?
That is a wonderful question, and depending on who you ask, you will get different answers. And I don't want to try to make a controversial issue more controversial, but we have to take one step back before we answer the question and identify the fact that size and number overlap with each other. And size overlaps with other issues like insulin resistance and diabetes. And so what we have is a mixture of things that keep company with one another. Whenever we pick one of those things out of a crowd, we have just created a need to ask lots of extra questions. So the way we became aware of size going back into the 70s and early 80s was we were interested in why certain people were having heart attacks with what appeared to be an absence of major risk factors. They weren't hypertensive. They weren't diabetic. They didn't have a high cholesterol, but they did have heart disease and they had had a heart attack. We're missing something. And so, in the process of evaluating the things we could measure, small size came up as a factor frequently in people who were having heart attacks and issues, but didn't have major risk factors. So, this idea that small size was significantly associated with risk is true. Now, the next question is why? Is it true that small size particles are worse than large size particles? And there are reasons to believe that might be true. When you're thinking about why a particle is bad in the first place, it has to move from the blood into the wall of the artery. Small particles might get in easier than large particles. That was an argument. Small particles, when they get in, could misbehave more than a large particle. That's another argument that people have. And all of these are plausible. So we call them plausibility arguments. It's plausible. Now, what else do we know? Well, we also know that when you have small size, you carry less stuff, right? A quart is smaller than a gallon. If I have a gallon of water, I need 4 quarts, or I can have a 1 gallon container. Just by volume, a small size carries less. So if I measure the same cholesterol, but my size is small versus large, I'm going to have a different number. By definition, just physical chemistry tells me I have to have a different number. So now you have to ask the question, if small size is associated with risk, is it still significantly predictive if I adjust for how many are there? Now we get into these unique adjusted models. And when I say adjusted, you're taking into account another factor. And you can do this many, many, many times. You can do it as many times as you want. You can say, I know a lot of things that are part of the same problem. And if I think one is really important, how much does it continue to be important as I take the other factors into consideration? When you do that, small size is no longer a significant predictor after you've adjusted for the number of particles present. All right, let's play that backwards. If I have the particle number, is it still predictive after I adjust for particle size? The answer is yes. So this is the new learning if we ask extra questions. So you could ask the question, is size important? It is. Is it the explanation in part? What else is going on? How many of the bad guys do you have? And what other issues are going on when size is small? So that's a better appreciation for why there is an association of size with risk due to other factors. So does that mean that I shouldn't care about size? It means that size is incomplete as a description. And a more complete description would be how many do I have and what else is going on? And when you start thinking that way, nobody's wrong. It's just a matter of a better detailed understanding if I ask more questions.
That's a good way to put it. That some views may be just focusing on a specific factor, but maybe neglecting others, and looking at the full picture gives us more understanding. So, to put this in concrete terms, people, let's say someone has two hypotheticals. Someone has a good level of LDL cholesterol and ApoB, and I realize we haven't formally defined ApoB, although most of my viewers are familiar with it. But if you want to briefly explain what that is, but the two hypotheticals would be someone has cholesterol and ApoB in the healthy range. Is there value to looking at particle size? And then the inverse, someone has high cholesterol slash ApoB is having is for example, is having most of the particles be large LDLs. Does that make it the ApoB safe?
So ApoB is a protein, and APO stands for apolipoprotein. So we just abbreviate apolipoprotein as APO. ApoB is a single protein per particle for every VLDL, LDL, IDL, and chylomicron that our body makes. The only thing that you really need to know is that of all the ApoB particles that our body makes, over 90% are LDL. So the vast majority of the ApoB pool is LDL. Not all ApoB-containing lipoproteins are equally likely to cause a blockage, heart attack, or stroke. The ones that are more likely include LDL, intermediate density, IDL, and triglyceride remnant particles. Those are the ones that are particularly bad. Very large VLDL and chylomicrons, not so much. Because they're so large, they don't get into the artery wall. They're part of other issues, but directly they don't participate in the process. So when we're talking about LDL, intermediate density lipoprotein, and triglyceride-rich remnants, even in that pool, the vast majority are LDL, unless you have a very unique genetic problem. So that's why, as we unpack this, many people are thinking of LDL particle number and ApoB as very similar terms, because ApoB, the pool of particles, is so overwhelmingly LDL. Okay, so these are where if your viewers have been looking at the different reports out there and they've been looking at the literature, what are we really talking about? Particle number as measured by ApoB, particle number as measured by LDL particle number, two very similar ideas, not exactly interchangeable, but very, very similar. Now, you asked the question, is there a size consideration having a lot or a little of large and small particles? Well, it depends on how you do the analysis. Again, you can do a single analysis and say, how many small particles do I have? And does that number of small particles have a significant association with events? Yes. Now, I'm going to introduce a new concept, and I don't want to lose anybody here, but you can have two things that are related to each other, and they can either make it harder to see, they can suppress the relationship between one variable and another. So I have a hand and I have a hand. You see my hands. You see them equally well now. No, because this hand is obscuring this hand. And this is called a suppressor variable effect. Large and small particles are all part of the LDL pool. And depending on how you handle the data, you can create a situation where the number of small particles obstructs your ability to see if large particles are contributing or not. And it's a very common thing called a stepwise logistic regression analysis. And when you do that stepwise analysis, I start with small. I add large. I don't see large anymore. Therefore, it's not important. Now, what you can do is you can relieve this suppressor variable effect by doing what's called all-in data modeling. You can put both of the actors at the same time, and you can ask the question, do these guys behave differently with their association with heart attacks and strokes? And the short answer is, for a one standard deviation change in the number, you have equal outcomes, small or large. So large is not less significant than small. Small is not more significant than large. The number of them is what's important. And so we can give some examples. Your viewers are probably familiar with a genetic problem called familial hypercholesterolemia, a genetic problem where you have high LDL from birth because you don't get rid of the particles after they've been made for any number of different reasons. Well, what are the types of particles that are present? Large. So you have a lot of large particles. And what happens to people who have a long exposure to high numbers of large particles? Early events, vascular disease. Okay, so large particles are not immune from causing blockage. What happens when you have a lot of small particles? Same thing. So it used to be the case that we thought small was worse than large. And if you had a lot of small, you had a lot of trouble. And large was the good fluffy particle. And if you had the good fluffy particle, maybe you didn't have much risk, even though you had a lot of. What informed that was this suppressor variable effect. Small looked really bad. Large didn't look so bad. Maybe if I have large, I'm okay. Well, let's look at them both side by side. And if I change by the same amount, large and small, they're both equally associated with heart attacks, strokes, and events. This is why we get back to the idea, take the number of bad guys down, and that's the most actionable thing you can do.
Mm-hmm. This suppression effect, is that because the number of small particles already at least partially subsumes the number of large particles because they kind of go together, or am I completely off?
It's really more of a statistical issue than anything else. It's how you handle interrelated variables. These ideas were tested, for example, in the VA HIT study, in women's health, in MESA, and other populations. And so when this was done, in these large outcome studies, heart protection study was another good example. Now, heart protection study, you've got 20,000 people. It's one of the largest intervention trials that has been published. And when you look at it in the usual way, in the usual stepwise way, the number of small particles were highly predictive of heart attacks, and the number of large were not. When you did this all-in data analysis, the same magnitude of change for one or the other was equally associated. And so it puts to rest this idea that there was a greater contribution to risk of small versus large if you account for this suppressor variable effect, right? And again, not to try to make this something that numbs people's minds when they try to think about it. Just think that LDL is bad. A lot of LDL is real bad, and LDL is a particle. The more particles, the more problem, be they large, be they small. The flip side of that is because certain types of conditions have lots of particles associated with them, like insulin resistance, like metabolic syndrome, part of that problem is lots of particles, and they happen to be small. So lots of small particles is part of the fabric of insulin resistance and metabolic syndrome. And this is a place where there's lots of data to say lots of small particles is very bad and predictive of events. That's absolutely true. You have to go to a different condition like FH, familial hypercholesterolemia, to see does a lot of large also give me a problem? It does. So two things can be true at the same time. A lot of small is bad, a lot of large is bad. Both are true. It doesn't have to be the case that one or the other is bad and the other one is just along for the ride.
Dr. Cromwell is so clear, so good at explaining these complex topics. I barely think this one needs a recap. So, real quick, having a lot of small LDLs is not good. Having a lot of large LDLs also does not appear to be good based on the bulk of the evidence. Particle size is not a useless metric. It can be an indicator that there's insulin resistance or some other metabolic issue, but neither size, small or large LDL, is harmless. They can both cause problems. And even particles much larger than any LDL size, like VLDL remnants, for example, can still cause problems. So it doesn't really matter how fluffy a particle is. Possibly the most important thing that Dr. Cromwell explained is why you might hear different ideas out there, that only the small LDLs are harmful and the fluffy ones are completely harmless. It's not that people are lying to you or completely making things up. There are studies suggesting a stronger risk associated with small, dense LDLs because they track with diabetes and obesity and some of these metabolic issues, and because of some of the statistical issues that Dr. Cromwell covered. But when you analyze them side by side, small and large LDLs, and when you account for the confounders, they both come up as significant risk predictors. So the bulk of the evidence points to keeping all of these sizes, small LDLs, large LDLs, in the healthy range, and the total number of atherogenic particles, that ApoB, in the healthy range. Here's a video on exactly how to do that with lifestyle measures. And if you're struggling with type 2 diabetes, here's a video on how to put that in remission. Check those out. I'll see you over there.